Good morning. It's my pleasure to introduce our next symposium. Thank you all for joining us for this symposium on theory, science, and implications of behavioral genetics. The goal of bringing these four talks together is to explore the promise of this new domain of scientific inquiry, considering why it has become so talked about, the problems that remain on the horizon, and some misconceptions that have already begun to permeate the public's understanding. To help us grapple with these questions, we have four speakers, each of whom studies behavioral epigenetics from a different perspective. Our first speaker will be David Moore, a developmental psychologist from Pitzer College and the Claremont Graduate University. He is currently serving as the director of developmental sciences program at NSF's Division of Behavioral and Cognitive Sciences, where he can apply his expertise on the contributions of genetic, environmental, and epigenetic factors to human development to articulate a vision for the future of developmental science. As a developmental systems theorist, Dr. Moore came to the study of epigenetics because of its potential to resolve age-old debate about the contributions of nature and nurture to the process of development. Dr. Moore argues that adopting an unwavering focus on development can help us refrain from thinking about nature and nurture as working in opposition, as in nature versus nurture. Research on behavioral epigenetics has validated the rejection of the nature-nurture dichotomy, but this research alone is unlikely to force the wholesale conceptual change that developmental systems perspective encourages. Our second speaker is Moshe Szyf, a geneticist and pharmacologist at the James McGill Professor of GlaxoSmithKline CIHR Chair in Pharmacology at McGill University. He has over 150 peer-reviewed articles on epigenetics and is the founding co-director of the Slacker Institute for Epigenetics and Psychobiology at McGill. Dr. Schiff's work includes impacts on both physical and mental health. He has pioneered the study of DNA methylation as a prime therapeutic target in cancer and other disease, and several patents related to this work. Dr. Schiff began studying epigenetic phenomena as a graduate student, and after joining forces with Michael Meany, helped launch the field of behavioral epigenetics by showing that maternal behavior can influence the epigenetic state of offspring in ways that influence the offspring's behavior into adulthood. His recent work with people and non-human primates indicates that exposures to drugs, injury, or unhealthy environments early in life can affect the functioning of the genome in ways that have important implications for mental health. The fact that epigenetic modifications are reversible holds out hope for the development of therapies for several behavioral pathologies. Our third speaker will be David Sweatt, a neurobiologist. He won numerous awards and honors, including the Ellison Medical Foundation Senior Scholar Award and election as a fellow of the American Association for the Advancement of Sciences. In 2013, he won the Ipsen Foundation International Prize in Neuroplasticity, one of the most prestigious awards in his scientific field. And Thomas Reuters has named him as highly cited researcher. His research focuses on the biomedical mechanisms underlying learning and memory, starting with the inspired insight that epigenetic processes are what ensure that when a cell divides, the resulting daughter cells remember the type of cell their parent was. He began to explore the possibility that the memories we mammals carry around in our brains also depend on epigenetic processes. A large amount of evidence has now accumulated to support the idea that formation and storage of behavioral memories rely on epigenetic mechanisms. This work, too, suggests that it could be useful to pursue epigenetic treatments for dementia and other memory-related pathologies, such as addiction and post-traumatic stress disorder. Our final speaker will be Amy Nahn, a genetic anthropologist who is assistant professor at UC San Diego. Dr. Nan will speak about how early experiences become literally incorporated into our bodies via epigenetic mechanisms. Because our early experiences reflect the social context in which we are embedded, there is a growing awareness that disparities that result from racial discrimination, traumatic encounters, or poverty, for example, can have health consequences for individuals exposed to these experiences many decades earlier in life. The possibility that these kinds of phenomena might help explain transgenerational persistence of health disparities across race and socioeconomic classes has drawn the attention of theorists working in several disciplines. Together, we hope these talks will provide a broad perspective on the still emerging field of behavioral epigenetics, encompassing developmental psychology, abnormal psychology, cognitive psychology, and health psychology. We've asked the speakers to leave 5 minutes at the end of each of their presentations for questions, during which we'll be able, after all four presentations, and we're hoping there might be an additional 5 minutes after all four presentations where we can take more general questions for the panel. So we'll starting with David Moore.
Many thanks to everyone for coming to our symposium on behavioral epigenetics. I'm very happy to be here and to be accompanied by these other esteemed scientists who will be speaking today. Deciding what to cover in my talk today was a challenge because I'm scheduled to give another talk tomorrow at 11 a.m. entitled The Developing Genome, Epigenetic Psychology and Developmental Science, a talk that will focus on my recent book of the same title. There it is, that's my book. Giving myself a little plug. If you're interested in coming, that talk will be in room 140B. My talk tomorrow is going to provide an overview of behavioral epigenetics. So I was really hoping that APA would schedule that talk before this one, because an overview of behavioral epigenetics would seem to be what we need to start this symposium. But that didn't happen, and I don't want to repeat myself tomorrow, so I hope you'll all excuse me if I just jump past some of the details about what epigenetics is, skip past the crucial data that have accumulated about how it works, leave this to my other colleagues today, and I'm going to move right on to some more philosophical questions that hang in the balance. Specifically, I'd like to talk about how behavioral epigenetics is transforming how we approach age-old questions about nature and nurture, and how our behavioral, biological, and psychological characteristics, all of our phenotypes really, come into being. So first, a quick and alliterative look at the structure of the talk. I'll be breaking it up into five parts. So without further ado, some brief history on the topic. Of course, people have been thinking about individuals' characters and their characteristics in terms of nature and nurture for centuries. In all that time, the belief has been widespread that some of our characteristics are more influenced by nature, or as we came to start thinking of it in the 20th century, DNA, whereas others are more influenced by nurture, the environments we experience as we develop. Despite this oppositional nature versus nurture kind of perspective, by the 1980s, most psychology textbooks were proclaiming that behavioral characteristics almost always result from the interaction of nature and nurture. But in this same era, data from twin and adoption studies, which were typical of traditional behavioral genetics, they were fostering the idea that even though gene-environment interactions are important, some of our characteristics really are mostly genetic. And my guess is that most psychologists these days would tell you that some of our phenotypes, specifically our biological ones like eye color, really are genetically determined. But in contrast to that point of view, in the closing decades of the 20th century, a number of developmental scientists, including these people, but quite a few other individuals as well. George, you're there. Good. Okay. Began arguing that the details of molecular biology indicate that all phenotypes emerge from gene-environment interactions, and that it's a mistake to conclude that some are more genetically determined than others. This theoretical perspective reflected the insights of developmental biologists from the 19th century, and their insight was that development is best characterized by a process known as epigenesis. And this was an idea originally put forth by Aristotle. But these days we think of epigenesis as a process wherein phenotypes emerge during development as a consequence of interactions between biological entities like DNA, cells, organs, whole individual people. And very importantly, epigenesis entails interactions between biological entities and their contexts. So DNA can interact with other biological entities within the context of cells. Cells can interact with other biological entities within the context of organs. Organs can interact with other biological entities within the context of bodies. And bodies interact with other biological entities within the context of the broader environment. So epigenesis is really about interactions between components of a developing system where the environmental context itself is recognized as another component of the system. And according to this perspective, there couldn't possibly be any such thing as a genetically determined phenotype, biological or psychological, because genetic factors are affected by their contexts. Somewhere between 10 and 20 years ago, data started to accumulate more rapidly on the mechanisms by which contextual factors influence gene expression. And this is what most of us now mean when we talk about epigenetics. I'm going to leave it to my colleagues who will speak after me today and to myself tomorrow to provide details about how environments literally get under our skin and influence gene expression. And instead, for now, I'm going to focus on the broader question of what this all might mean. This is sort of a generic picture of a chromosome unwound, and it shows some epigenetic marks. It's very useful when you're talking about the details of epigenetics, but like I said, I'm going to skip over that. I'm going to start talking about some of the hype surrounding behavioral epigenetics. One of the central bits of hype is that behavioral epigenetics is poised to finally abolish the nature-nurture controversy once and for all. And that makes some sense. If factors normally associated with nurture, such as diet and parenting, literally alter the chemical structure of DNA in ways that change how it functions, then DNA sequence information, the order of the bases, couldn't possibly determine phenotype single-handedly. Because these processes start immediately after conception and continue unabated throughout our entire lives, old ways of thinking about nature and nurture simply have to be wrong. And this hype, I would argue, is almost certainly warranted. Developmentalists had already inferred that phenotypes emerge via interactions, and the new data that we're getting from behavioral epigenetics labs merely confirm that theoretical insight. Some other hype that has captured the imagination of the media and the general public focuses on the transgenerational transmission of epigenetic information. And this idea suggests that our ancestors' experiences might have affected their DNA in ways that could be influencing our phenotypes. Interpreting the hype in this case is a bit more complicated. On the one hand, there's now relatively incontrovertible data that in some species, some contextual factors can influence some epigenetic marks in an animal in ways that alter the phenotypes of that animal's descendants. Nonetheless, this story has a lot of people quite exercised, and that's because it flies in the face of longstanding biological theory that says the experiences of one generation cannot affect the phenotypes of later generations. The latter idea, that ancestors' experiences can affect descendants' phenotypes, is associated with this poor man, Jean-Baptiste de Lamarck, often called the whipping boy of modern biology. He's a French naturalist who offered an early theory of evolution about 200 years ago. And his ideas have long been seen by theoretical biologists as anti-Darwinian and therefore heretical and deserving of withering scorn. For this reason, there's been a lot of pushback against the idea that epigenetic phenomena might have a significant role to play in inheritance. For instance, this was an editorial that appeared several years ago in a very prestigious journal, Current Biology. The editor was at pains to link the politically charged pseudoscientific ideas of the Soviet biologist Trofim Lysenko to the modern idea that environmentally induced epigenetic changes might be heritable. Thank you. And in fact, this remains one of the holes in our understanding. At present, there is no particularly compelling data that I'm aware of that proves the existence of epigenetic inheritance in human beings. Even though you might have heard that there is such thing, there really isn't very strong data. Having said that, there's good evidence that there is such phenomena happening in other mammalian species. Having said that, the number of examples of this phenomenon remains very small, even in other species. So there's a lot of additional work to be done before we get to the bottom of this story. Which leads me to want to talk about some of the holes in what we know. Before I do, I want to say that despite the ongoing controversy there is about epigenetic inheritance, it's important to recognize that even if epigenetic inheritance turns out to be impossible, that is, if it turns out that existing evidence for the phenomenon is spurious, however unlikely that might seem at present, this would not mean that the insights of epigenetics are any less important. Even if epigenetic inheritance is impossible, it's still incredibly important that within an individual's lifetime, that person's DNA sequence cannot determine her phenotypes. Because remember, if sequence information, the order of bases that make up the genetic code, if that can be used in different ways in different contexts, genotyping is never going to provide us with definitive, accurate predictions about developmental outcomes. And that remains an important insight, regardless of what we ultimately learn about epigenetic inheritance. All right, given the time, I think I've said enough about the holes. I'm going to move on to talk about some of the hopes, some of the reason this line of research has generated some excitement. Some developmentalists have understood for decades that development involves interactions between biological entities and their contexts. And for these scientists, the discoveries of epigenetics honestly haven't been all that surprising. But the discoveries have revealed the mechanisms by which experience can influence genetic activity. And these discoveries are incredibly important because they suggest ways to influence development, and they stoke hopes of potential epigenetic treatments for various conditions. At present, the U.S. Food and Drug Administration has already approved epigenetic treatments for some forms of cancer, and animal research has raised the prospect of developing epigenetic treatments for some psychological disorders too, including Alzheimer's disease and other forms of dementia, addictive behaviors, post-traumatic stress disorder, and perhaps even some of the consequences of child abuse. Here, too, there remain a lot of gaps in our knowledge, so there's a lot of work still to be done. In particular, the epigenetic state of different cell types are normally different. So epigenetic treatments that rely on traditional forms of drug administration, such as taking a pill or even an injection, those are unlikely to be appropriately targeted because they'll work on a variety of cell types, even though you only want to target one cell type. And the upshot is that they're likely to generate numerous bad side effects. In spite of this, there's reason for optimism in the long run. People are already hard at work trying to find ways to target these treatments to specific cell types. Before drawing some conclusions from this talk, I'd like to address three issues that we need to keep our eyes on moving forward. These are pitfalls that might stand in our way. Given the new data on epigenetics and the prior insights of developmental science, some older ideas seem bound for the trash heap of history. One is the nature-nurture dichotomy. Another is biological determinism in general. The third is the idea that we can apportion the effects of genes and environments on phenotypes. Without a wholesale change of perspective, new data alone will not be enough to dispense with these older ideas. So as I've thought about this more, I've realized that these can all survive the accumulating data coming from behavioral epigenetics labs. So first, with regards to the dichotomous thinking about nature and nurture, some theorists have already suggested that epigenetics research simply moves the boundary between nature and nurture closer to the gene. And although that move effectively grants more importance to nurture, the dividing line is still there, and it still supports the persistence of a nature-nurture dichotomy. So I personally don't find this line of argument very compelling because epigenetic modifications actually change the chemical structure of DNA. For those of you who remember your chemistry, these epigenetic marks produce covalent bonds with either DNA or the proteins around which DNA is wrapped. And those kinds of changes alter the DNA structure. So I don't think that you can make the case that there still is a clear-cut dividing line. If nurture can alter nature starting immediately upon conception, and of course it goes the other way, we know that nature obviously alters nurture, because organisms certainly alter their own environments. It makes no sense to continue imagining that nature and nurture are separable contributors to developmental outcomes. Second, with regards to biological determinism, it won't necessarily die out because of epigenetics research. Even though genetic determinism has become increasingly untenable, it's possible for theorists to adopt an epigenetic determinism in its place. Epigenetic determinism would entail imagining that if you know the epigenetic state of an organism, you can make unerring predictions about developmental outcomes. This is just one of many papers I could have chosen that serves as an example. Here, an epigenetic change is associated with a disorder in mice, but the epigenetic change itself is associated with a sequence information variation in DNA. And so even though it looks like this is all about epigenetics, it's still really about the genes driving the story. This form of biological determinism is no less fraught with conceptual difficulties than genetic determinism, because epigenetic states can change as a function of experience. Biological determinism in general, whether it's genetic, epigenetic, or some other type, now appears to be unwarranted. Epigenetics can also fail to revolutionize our thinking because of its close relationship with other molecular processes. So remember when I was talking about Aristotelian epigenesis, that focuses attention on interactive processes. But contemporary epigenetics has come to entail a sharp focus on molecular biology. And that focus is liable to draw attention back to DNA and away from the actual interactive processes that give rise to phenotypes. And some theorists have already posited the existence of a so-called histone code, which is clearly epigenetic because this thing that's pictured down here is a histone protein around which DNA is wrapped. It's not even DNA itself. So this is a very important molecule in epigenetic research. The argument that there is a histone code could potentially be misunderstood as an epigenetic equivalent to the idea of the genetic code, which fueled biological determinism in the 20th century. Finally, it remains possible to simply incorporate epigenetic phenomena into old and, frankly, outdated conceptual structures. So, for example, consider scientific approaches that rely on statistical techniques and methodologies designed to apportion variation in phenotypes to variation in genes and environments. These approaches have their work in the 19th century work of Francis Galton. And Galton, living when he did, had conceptualizations that were firmly rooted in a nature-nurture dichotomy. So any subsequent work is probably going to bring that conceptual baggage right along with it. Galton's approach, often applied to data collected in twin and adoption studies, involve equations that look like this, where P is the phenotype, G is the effect of genes, little e is the effect of the environment, and the G by E term here is a gene by environment interaction. Using this conceptual frame, behavioral geneticists have worked very hard to determine how much of the variation in a phenotype across a population can be accounted for by variation in that population's genotypes. Because equations like this include a G by E term, the conceptual frame offers the illusion of the ability to learn something about the extent to which genes and environments interact during phenotype development. But you got to keep in mind that this approach is merely apportioning variance across a population. It's not actually giving us any information at all about actual causal processes, which is to say physical interactions between genes and environments that give rise to phenotypes. And a very simple proof of that statement is available when you start thinking about it. You might do a twin study, try to apportion genetic and environmental variance, and you might find that in a given study in a certain population, all of the variation in the phenotype is accounted for by variation in the genotype. If it's all accounted for by variation in the genotype, it gives the impression that the gene by environment interaction isn't doing anything. And that may be true in a statistical sense, but we know from molecular biology that all phenotypes arise through the physical interactions of genes and environments. So this gives a misleading impression that gene environment interactions could potentially not be important. regardless of whether or not a statistical G by E interaction is detected in a given study, it remains the case that phenotype emergence always involves physical mechanical interactions between genetic and non-genetic components of developing systems. So why is this important in the context of epigenetics? Some theorists have already suggested that epigenetic variants could and actually should be incorporated into traditional behavioral genetic equations, which just gives a more complex equation. It includes a term here that the theorists I'm talking about called M for methylation, and it gives the impression that epigenetic marks can interact with other factors. But here, too, you have the same problem you always did. And in fact, doing this squanders the potential of epigenetic research to draw attention to the physical mechanical interactions that yield phenotypes. Instead, it reinforces the outdated idea that correlational studies of twins and adoptees can yield useful information about how important genetic, environmental, or epigenetic factors are in the development of a given phenotype. Since epigenetic phenomena can be shoehorned into older conceptual frameworks like this, empirical evidence about epigenetics per se can't be expected to revolutionize thinking about how nature and nurture produce phenotypes in development. The emergence of a new zeitgeist will require more of a philosophical reorientation, one that emphasizes the centrality of developmental processes in phenotype production. I'm at zero. I'm out of time. I had a couple conclusions. These are actually the exact same conclusions that are going to end my talk tomorrow. So maybe rather than concluding these, I will just invite you all to that talk, and then we can talk about it more. That's a 50-minute talk, so I'll have some additional time. For now, I think I better stop. So let me see if there are any questions. We have about 4 minutes for those. My talk tomorrow is at 11 o'clock, 140B. It's going to be a lot more molecular. This was a sort of a philosophy of science kind of talk. Other questions? Yes. The question was, is it the case that biology is still setting the limits, even though we're learning more about how genes and environments interact? And my guess is that there are legions of biologists out there who would say that that is the case. But I'm here to tell you that they're wrong. I'm sorry to be so blunt about that. But if, in fact, environmental factors are able to influence how biological development unfolds, then the environment is critical. Personally, I have become increasingly uncomfortable with the dichotomy between biology and environment. Even that is a dichotomy that's weird. In fact, development is best thought of, in my opinion, as a single unitary process that involves both. So I don't really want to say that biology is not critically important, because it is. But that by itself is not going to tell the whole story, because the environment is influencing the biology. All right, my guess is that my colleagues will have as much to say as I, which is to say too much. So we'll move on, even though we're a little bit early, and turn it over to Moshe Szyf.
First, I want to thank David not only for giving us this beautiful introduction to the field, a philosophical overview, which makes my life easier now, but also organizing this symposium and promoting the idea of behavioral epigenetics in the psychological world. I was asked to give you notes about what I'm going to talk. I usually don't do that, because I have no idea what I'm going to talk about. And it is a dynamic interaction between me and the audience. But these are the points I'm going to talk about. And I'll move immediately to the question that I try to deal with in this talk, which is, as you heard from David, geneticists have taught me and my colleagues that genotype equals phenotype. And this has been the major drive behind the major human effort to sequence as many genomes as possible, to get final answers, to understand the diversity of phenotypes. But this idea in its simplistic deterministic form has been questioned from the beginning. So even before we knew about the double helix structure, Waddington noticed that in embryology, it was clear we all have the same genome with slight differences between cells, and still we probably express millions of different phenotypes. So that means one identical piece of DNA can do so many different things. That happens in development. Nobody questions that. 50 years of biochemistry have dissected and analyzed many of the mechanisms that make the same piece of DNA look so different in the eye and the liver and the hippocampus and the dentate gyrus and other places. The first layer of change is within the molecule itself. So if we take a DNA from a Neanderthal that died 40,000 years ago, we can sequence the DNA, the genetics, and get an idea about who his father and mother were, what is his ancestry. But we can also sequence the pattern of methylation on the DNA that will give us an idea about the cellular identity of that DNA. We could say without mistake that it comes from a liver or a particular class of neurons. So each DNA that you have, that you extract chemically with a lot of very harsh chemicals, has two layers of information. One is the genetic information, and the other one is the cellular identity. And there's no question, even among the greatest determinist, that that's true. But that's still deterministic, highly predictable. Every single one in this room will have the same DNA methylation pattern in every neuron on every liver cell to a certain extent, so much so that my computer will take that DNA and will tell you without any question, this is DNA from the liver. But the next question is that we know from psychology and from medicine that these interactions are extremely important, the diet of the mother and the child. How does this work? We also know that these interactions don't happen as a diet. They happen in social, physical, and environmental context. And they will make a huge impact on the phenotype. So there are two ways to approach it. One is to say, it really doesn't make a difference. It's an illusion. Everything is defined by the genetic inheritance that you came into this world. And the reason why you find yourself here is because you have good genes. And you find yourself here because you have bad genes. And your mother treats you well because she inherited those genes that make her treat you well. And it's the same genes that will make you rich and make you smart. So it's possible to argue that. But the other argument that I will present you is perhaps the same mechanism that evolution has developed to give two absolutely identical pieces of DNA enormous variance can not only provide the cellular identity of DNA, but also the experiential identity of DNA. So perhaps all these things that we as hardcore scientists considered soft science work to exactly the same mechanisms by which development is shaping the same DNA to its different forms. And the first evidence that we had that this is possible came from a random meeting that I had with Michael Meany, an unusual meeting with a lot of beer, where he told me that he is interested in how mother rats treat their pups. And to be honest with you, I thought this is the greatest waste of my hard-earned Canadian taxes to do that. But what transpired after a lot of alcohol is that when you look at these rats, there's a natural distribution that we all as humans see in humans and you can see in any group of animals, that some mothers do a lot of it and some do a little of it. You can quantify it. And then what he and his colleagues did is follow these rats to adulthood. And he was particularly interested in stress phenotypes. Now we know it's not just stress phenotypes that are different. And these animals who received high and low licking and grooming have different stress responses. The nice thing about stress is you can start connecting it biochemically and understand that perhaps there is some biochemistry going on between this ephemeral story about maternal love. And the question was how? And I was just excited about discoveries that I made in cancer, in how DNA methylation might play a causal role in driving cancer, in changing the way a DNA identity from a liver identity to a cancerous liver identity. And we thought perhaps similar mechanism might be involved in mediating between the world and the DNA. But the best evidence we had that this is not genetic is the cross-fostering experiment. So what you can do in animals, which you cannot do with humans, is you cannot randomize control child abuse in humans to test whether it's child abuse that caused the problems or the genetics that caused the child abuse to start with that caused the problems. In rat world, you can do that. You can cross-foster animals who receive different kinds of maternal care and demonstrate that the phenotypes that these rats will develop have nothing to do with their biological mother, but everything to do with their caring mother. Which also suggests that perhaps a big vector of inheritance is not just our sperm and eggs, but who takes care of us when we were young. And we spent more than a decade in unraveling a pathway, a conduit, a mechanistic possibility that the world can talk to DNA. And the licking and grooming of, so this is the proposal. It's not etched in stone yet, but it gives us a working hypothesis on how these things are possible. Elicits signaling pathways in the brain, which talk to intermediate proteins that deliver essentially chromatin grooming enzymes to the gene. In this case, it was the glucocorticoid receptor, but many other genes that can shape and groom the gene to look as a very active gene with different kinds of epigenetic modifications or as inactive gene with other kinds of epigenetic modification. But the basic idea is here that we're looking at some sort of a steady state. There's no animal that doesn't do any maternal care. That pup will not survive. And there's no mother that does infinite amount of maternal care. And most animals are in between. So essentially, we get a distribution of phenotypes, almost an infinite distribution of phenotypes, based on this kind of feeding into the system by the mother. The other important thing here is that epigenetic is reversible. And my excitement with epigenetic in cancer was that we can develop drugs that can convert the gene from looking like this to looking like this. Because the fact that this gene is like this or like this has to do with enzymes that we can target with drugs. So we could also show that if we inject epigenetic drugs to the brain of the adult rats, we can change their phenotype to either look like the high or the low. So on one hand, we have here an extremely stable phenotype. And actually, this phenotype is transgenerationally inherited. On the other hand, but not through the germline, but through the behavior of the mother, which is a very powerful vector of inheritance. On the other hand, it is reversible. So it means that we need to think about genes as some sort of a steady state, not as a final state. So development will define, embryological development that is restricted by evolutionary rules will define a certain form of a balance, but this balance between activity and inactivity of a gene is influenced by many, many different factors. And these factors could be drugs that we are so scared of, or could be, I'm moving too much, right? That's my major problem. Or it could be behavior. And one of the things that is very obvious to you or to anybody who thinks about it, that behavior is chemical, right? As I talk to you, David Sweatt will tell you about all the chemicals that are released in your brain. The biggest pharmaceutical industry is just happening in front of you now that you listen to my talk. So this dichotomy between physical and mental is, of course, has no basis in science. I want to talk about the general idea about what is going on with those rats and with those little humans or little horses and dogs and ants and bees that come into this world. They come with the genetic information that was fashioned by millions of years of evolution. But evolution did not predict whether you're going to be born in Ecuador or Stockholm. So your circadian clock is going to be totally different in these two environments and have a huge impact on your physiology or mental health. So that's the physical environment. It also didn't predict which kind of bacteria you're going to face. Are you going to be born in a farm with a lot of horses? Or are you going to be born in a clean place where your mother is showering herself 20 times a day and you're never exposed to any bacteria? Or what kind of social environment you're going to be born in? It's going to be aggressive? Will you have to fight for your life? Are you going to be born in an upper class a kind of social environment where you have to be nice and socially fit and appropriate to survive? And all these things feed into signaling pathways. So the idea is it's not that the environment does some chaotic stuff and your genome is changing, but there are mechanisms that evolved in evolution that read those signals and groom the genome to create a phenotype that is now adaptive to these signals. And trouble comes when there's a misfit between the anticipated environment and the real environment. So if your mother, for example, the known Barker hypothesis, if you get a signal from your mother, you're going to be born into a poor, aggressive, mean world, which means you will have a meal maybe once every month. And you develop your hypothalamus to binge and your metabolic tissues to store everything as fat because this will save your life. And then it's the United States where calories are cheap. And being poor doesn't necessarily mean you have no access to calories. The same mechanism that can protect you can now cause disease. And you can think about any human phenotype in the same way. And this is where you get to health challenges. So another evidence that this thing happens not only in rats, but closer to us, came from the work that we did with Steve Sumi. And I'm sure most of you know about this work, where he followed animals that were either reared with a mother or a surrogate. And we could examine for the first time in a randomized fashion, what is the signature of the mother in the genome of the offspring? And how early does the animal know, does the primate know, whether he has or not a mother? And this is a methylation analysis, a genome-wide methylation analysis at day 14 of monkeys that either had or didn't have a real mother rearing them. And what you see here in every row is a gene, and the color indicates how highly methylated it is. So we're not going into the details here, but what you can see is you can easily cluster those animals very early in life based on the fact that they had or not had a mother. So this behavioral change of removing the real mother and supplying a surrogate instead had already a remarkable change on the immune system. And that's another important point. A lot of psychologists or psychiatrists think that humans are bodiless minds, and my fellow physicians think that humans are mindless bodies. But really, the immune system has a very, very strong dialogue that peer review committees of grant proposals have never learned between the immune system and the brain. And the reason is that environments never come alone. Bacteria and inflammation and getting wounded is associated with social anxiety and stress and strife. And so it makes sense that the immune system is preparing itself for this kind of life signals that they get early in life. But these signals emerge even earlier than 14 days. So here we looked at social status in monkeys. Monkeys like us rank themselves. We like to rank ourselves all the time. And if you put 5 monkeys in a room, you'll obviously get the boss, the deputy, the department manager, and the peon. And they have very different phenotypes. And so we're looking at the placentas of animals that were born to either high rank or low rank mothers. These are rhesus monkeys. And when I saw this classification, I was astonished because it looked to me as classifying tumor versus normal tissue. So there were really dramatic differences in the placentas, even before they felt the social interaction. It's their mother feeling the social interaction or being in a low rank or a high rank that had these changes. And when you look at the pathways that are affected in maternal separation and in weaning and other pathways, what comes up are the pro-inflammatory pathways. And what we can do now in biology is actually not just look at beautiful red and green pictures clustering people based on behavioral experiences, but starting to analyze the pathways, the physiological pathways that are affected by these behavioral influences. And these are the pathways that usually emerge. And the other interesting thing that we can do is to see whether methylation differences in placenta can predict social status. And I've done a penalized regression on all the thousands methylation sites that differentiate baby rhesus monkeys based on the status of their mother, and found two that were sufficient to predict the status of the mother. And they also can predict whether the mother is high status or low status, medium status, and high status. So that means that perhaps one day we will have physical marks of early adversity that will be associated with risk that could help the psychologist as a psychiatrist the same way the general practitioner measures our blood pressure and cholesterol levels and HDL and LDL as markers of trouble that is pursuing. In humans, it's very difficult, as we said before, to demonstrate that. So we took advantage of God playing experiments with people, where God does randomized controlled trials on people, and that's natural disaster. One that happened in my province of Quebec is the Quebec ice storm of 1998, which was the toughest, hardest natural disaster in Canadian history, and it involved ice coming from the sky for a long time. In the dead of winter, the electric grid of Quebec collapsed, and just think about a mother who is pregnant during that time. And since Quebec is a highly sophisticated society, and nobody died from the ice storm.
Five more minutes? Four more?
Okay. But some people, of course, experience very high stress. And here we could, Suzanne King, a colleague at McGill, could provide an objective storm score and ask the question whether their children, who are now 15, who were 15 years old at the time, in their immune system, had signatures of the maternal stress. And what you can see here is, with using the same analysis as the genome-wide DNA methylation analysis, the changes in methylation correlate with the increase in stress. The other thing you see is not one gene that is changing. It's a network of genes that is changing. And you can see that they can change both ways. It's not that they become more or less methylated. Some genes become more methylated and others become less methylated. And here again, you can develop a methylation score that predicts how much stress the mother of that adolescent has experienced. Again, giving me optimism that perhaps we could be able to use it in diagnosis. The other interesting thing is the question whether we could reverse epigenetic programming. And I know David is going to talk about it as well. And I just gave you one example where we could reverse it. We could reverse the maternal high and low licking behavior of the pups by providing them with epigenetic drugs that could go one way or the other. Since I'm short of time, I'll stop here. I'll just conclude that the implications of a lifelong dynamic epigenome are huge, of course, for our understanding of who we are, as well as understanding medicine, as understanding politics, understanding economics, understanding psychology and psychiatry. Because now these classical dichotomies between people who studied hard sciences and people who studied soft sciences have to come to an end at some point. Because the chemical spheres, the biospheres, and the social spheres are probably feeding on similar pathways, signaling pathways that shape our epigenome to create a phenotype. But the message that I would like to deliver based on my experience in the field is that doesn't stop when you are a baby. And these interactions continue, and we keep talking to the chemical biosphere and social worlds, and these are affecting our epigenome again. But when they affect our epigenome, there is already an epigenome they affect which. So if we experience exactly the same experience, we come out of the experience in very different ways based on the script that we had in our genome before. So I look at the developing epigenome not as a book, but as a movie, but interactive movie. You know, those movies where you can remove an actor and see what happens. And so it depends when you remove the actor and depends what happened before. So each scene will define the next scene in very unanticipated ways. And this is perception of a constantly dynamic, interactive world, rather than in a final state that we can map at a certain point and will give us a final picture, I think is ought to change everything, including the way we educate doctors and psychologists to understand this kind of interaction. So conclusions are that the dynamic relations in between the environment and genome shapes the phenotype. These interactions are mediated by epigenetic processes. And this has huge potential diagnostic, intervention, and therapeutic implications, which I would have loved to talk to you, but that will take more time. And in the end, the acknowledgments to all the people that were involved, both collaborators and students and postdoctoral fellows in coming up with the ideas presented here. Greatest thank to the methyl group that kept me busy since I was 19 and kept my family growing, sent them to college, and get me into retirement. Thank you. So for example, the first experiment that we did, so the question was about reversibility, not only in childhood by, let's say, early intervention, but also later in life. Of course, it's more difficult to reverse things as they accumulate, right? So if you remove an actor from the last script, it will be very difficult to reverse the entire script, but not impossible. And what we did with the rats that received high or low maternal care was to treat them with epigenetic drugs when they were adults. And that has reversed their phenotype. So theoretically, there should be no boundaries to the possibility of reversibility. The only boundaries is the limit of our knowledge on how to do it. But potentially, it is reversible. And a lot of neurodevelopmental things that we thought are not reversible appear to be reversible.
And I'm familiar with your work on the drugs you've worked with. And if those three social environments are interactive, would it then, I mean, is it too far to suggest that at some point we might understand reversibility, not just in terms of a chemical, but in terms of environments and human interactions?
Absolutely. And I think there's already emerging studies on the effect of exercise. Some people are measuring psychological interventions before and after. And if you think about the way the human body functions and the way the brain functions, there should be no difference between a behavioral intervention and a chemical intervention. The difference is that the behavioral intervention taps into the regulated pathways, whereas a chemical intervention bypasses that by flooding the system with a drug that kind of bypasses the normal regulatory systems. But if we understood enough how our behavioral interventions are tapping into the brain and changing the chemistry there, obviously it should work better than drugs. Yeah.
How long until this happens routinely in clinical practice?
Beg your pardon? Yeah.
How many years till this is routine clinical practice?
I have no idea. And the boundary is not the technology. The boundary is in the minds of people. So the speed by which certain medical revolutions take place has to do with the acceptance of the ideas by the general practitioners, whether in medicine, psychology, social work, and other fields. And the fascinating side of epigenetics is the psychology of epigenetics and the psychology of scientists and why certain ideas pick up and certain ideas generate resistance. And that's why it's very hard to predict how certain fields die for 100 years and then they come up again, and others immediately pick up. And so therefore, I don't have an answer. But if we were allowed the complete freedom, probably a decade was enough, but it could be a century.
Okay, very good. Thank you, David, for organizing this symposium. It's fantastic. It's like eating candy for me to hear these talks. And I'm going to plug David Moore's book also. It's one of the, it's really, really a good book. It's really well written. It's very informative. And if you have any interest in this area that's piqued by this seminar, this symposium, really get his book and read it because it's fantastic. So I'm going to talk about our work where we've been investigating the role of epigenetic molecular mechanisms in memory formation and storage. And my lab has, for 30 years or so, I've been working on trying to understand how long-term memories are formed and stored in the mammalian nervous system. And one of the big conceptual advances in the memory field, in my opinion, over the last few decades was the discovery and the realization that active changes in gene transcription, active changes in gene readout, are absolutely necessary for you to form and store any long-term memory. So anything that you remember about this symposium today, for example, will have required that this experience changed gene readout in your brain to allow you to remember it tomorrow. So if you remember anything for 24 hours, it has required a change in gene readout in your brain to be able to do that. So it's a fascinating question how that works, and that's what my lab works on. How is this active regulation of gene readout in response to a behavioral experience mediated mechanistically? So my first couple of slides, I don't have to even talk about because there were major themes of the first two talks. And so one of the implications of this discovery and others is there's this apparent historical dichotomy between nature and nurture is no longer a valid construct. And so you've heard all about that. But that's one of the important messages, which is we now know that for memory, specifically for my talk, that your experiences drive changes in gene readout in the brain, and now we're investigating the role of epigenetic mechanisms in that memory-associated gene readout that mediates long-term behavioral change. And this slide, I don't have to go into in any kind of detail. These days, it seems obvious that one might look at epigenetic mechanisms in learning and memory because we know from developmental biology that epigenetic mechanisms are part of the information storage that makes a nerve cell be a nerve cell for your whole life and your liver cells be liver cells for your whole life. So they're a fundamental information storage mechanism in cells. And so we were interested in the possibility that these robust lifelong information storage mechanisms in cells might be actively regulated by experience and be involved in long-term behavioral change in the nervous system in post-developmental neurons in the brain. And so that's how we got into this. And I'm going to give you a few stories where we've investigated the role of epigenetic mechanisms in regulating gene readout associated with memory, where we tested the hypothesis. And the first mechanism that we began to look at when we developed this hypothesis was something that you've heard about already, which is chemical modifications of the tails of histone protein. So this is what the DNA double helix in a chromatin particle looks like in three dimensions in reality. And these core proteins that DNA is wrapped around in all the genes and all the cells in your body is subject to chemical modification. And so we asked, okay, we'll do an experiment. We'll put in a drug that can manipulate, this case, acetylation of histones in the brain, and see if it does anything to the animal's memory capacity to begin to test this hypothesis. This was the very first experiment that we did, and Jonathan Levinson did this. And this is just one example of that kind of experiment. We were using a fear conditioning paradigm. I'm not going to get into the particulars of the behavioral experiments, but basically it's a way that we can test an animal's recollection of an experience that happened a day before, where they got an aversive, and it's a Pavlovian associative conditioning training paradigm. And you can measure, as a memory index, the robustness of their subsequent behavioral change 24 hours later. And we put this drug called sodium butyrate in, which is a very nonspecific histone deacetylase inhibitor, put it into the animal. And in fact, it changed the animal's memory capacity. As you can see here, the control animals had a recollection index this big, and we had a statistically significant increase in the animal's memory capacity, or memory for the event 24 hours later. So we were doing the experiment to try to test the hypothesis that this mechanism might be involved, and that these data are consistent with that, so that was good. But it also didn't escape our attention that what we had sort of stumbled upon, if you want to look at it that way, is a cognitive enhancer, right? So this makes animals smarter, makes their memories more robust, and so that has some pretty obvious therapeutic applications, and I'm going to potential applications, and I'll return to that at the end of my toward the end of my talk. So histone modifications then were in play as something that could regulate long-term memory formation in response to experience. Then we decided to go after the prima donna of epigenetics, as it's been referred to in the literature, which is DNA methylation that you've heard about. This is sort of the first pass. This is the mechanism that can shut a gene off completely in a liver to keep it from being a neuron and so on and so forth in all the different kinds of cells. And so we were interested in testing whether DNA methylation, cytosine methylation, might be involved in active long-term memory formation in the adult nervous system as well. And I'm going to go into the biochemistry here a little bit because it's going to become relevant later. So this is the chemical modification, this covalent chemical change of DNA that happens, this methylation that you've heard a lot about. But I want to point out a little bit about the biochemistry, which is you have complementary strands of DNA. And so the nucleotide sequences are complementary for each other. So a methyl group gets put on one of these strands, and then that's called de novo methylation, and one set of enzymes do that. But then another set of enzymes see that what's referred to as hemimethylated DNA, and then they put a methyl group on the complementary strand on the other strand. Okay? So the point is that you have these two methyl transferases, these two enzymes that can put these methyl groups on there, and what it sets up in the cell is a self-perpetuating biochemical reaction. Okay? You see, you put the first methyl group on, this enzyme sees the methyl group there, puts it on the other strand. If this one happens to come off or degrade for some reason, the same enzyme can see the hemimethylated DNA and replace it. So you have essentially like a chain reaction that's set up in the cell that can make this modification last the entire lifetime. Okay. And this is really the reason why we got interested in this in the context of behavioral memory, because it's a self-perpetuating, lifelong chemical change in response to a transient signal, which is the molecular essence of long-term memory. So we tested in a similar way a prediction of the hypothesis. So we put an inhibitor of DNA methyltransferases into the dorsal hippocampus in animals use an area part of the brain that's involved in this long-term fear memory that we study, and put it in before we train the animal, looked 24 hours later, and here's what the control animals look like in these experiments. These are two different inhibitors of DNMTs, and you can see that there was a significant degradation of the animal's long-term memory capacity. So it's consistent with the hypothesis that DNA methylation, active regulation of methylation by DNA methyltransferases, is necessary for animals, the implications being you as well, to make a stable long-term memory. So that put DNA methylation in play in our mind. And these results were reviewed with quite a bit of skepticism, actually. But now it's become much more, it's been highly replicated and much more believed, generally speaking. So summarizing about what's almost 20 years of work now from our lab and a lot of other labs, by manipulating the epigenome, we can enhance memory formation with histone deacetylase inhibitors. We, as an aggregate group of, you know, behavioral epigeneticists, we can block memory formation with inhibiting DNA methyltransferases. And actually, in a series of experiments that we did, we could make a stable memory, this fear memory. We know that it was stable for 30 days, put a DNA methyltransferase inhibitor in the animal's brain, in the right part of the brain that's involved in the storage of that memory, and actually erase the memory. So we can erase the memory, we can block memory formation, and we can enhance memory formation by manipulating the epigenome. So quite a robust set of reactions in terms of controlling memory. And as you already heard, this is a major take-home message of all the talks today, basically, at least so far. The epigenome is dynamic over your lifespan, and it changes in response to your experiences. And part of what that is involved in is make the memories that you make in response to your experiences. So for the last second half of the talk, I'm going to go through three vignettes where we've sort of capitalized on this concept more recently, and some of it's going to be quite speculative, but it'll be food for thought. And this next section is going to get pretty hairy in terms of the molecular biology that's involved, but stick with me. I'm going to try to keep it reasonably approachable. So there's a major hole, using an earlier term, in epigeneticists' understanding of how epigenetics work, which is nobody knows how one specific cytosine gets picked out to be methylated. So you have about a little bit less than a billion cytosines in your DNA sequence, and some of them get methylated specifically in a highly reproducible fashion, and some don't, and nobody knows how that works, and I don't know how. I'm not going to tell you how it works in this talk, because we haven't figured it out, but trying to start to get at that question was what got us into this this first vignette I'm going to talk about. So there are certain types of RNAs that are called long non-coding RNAs. So you're familiar with messenger RNAs that are transcribed out of the gene, out of the DNA sequence, and then they're turned into proteins to make a functional product in the cells in your body. So that's messenger RNAs, but there's also other categories of RNAs that are regulatory molecules. They're not turned into proteins, but they regulate gene readout. And there was a form of long non-coding RNA that was discovered recently by a group at Harvard, and they named that specific kind of RNA an extra-coding, an ecRNA, because it has extra nucleotide sequences outside of the span that would be the coding region that codes for the gene product, the mRNA and the protein. So it's a regulatory RNA, and it has these extra coding sequences on them. That's the molecular definition of an extra coding RNA. So we began to ask the question, does this category of regulatory RNA exist in the animal's nervous system? And the model for how these extra coding RNAs work is You get a given gene reads out an mRNA, and it makes a gene product, a protein. And then in parallel, an extra coding RNA is made, and it is coils up into a particular specific structure, and it blocks DNA methyltransferases to keep this gene active so that the methyltransferases can't methylate the gene and turn it off. Okay? So that's what the proposed role for these regulatory RNAs is, these extra coding RNAs. And so we were interested in that, and whether that might be operating in the brain. And Don't get scared. I'm going to tell you what this means. We sequenced all of the gene products in cortical neurons from rats and asked, okay, how many of these genes have something that looks like an extra coding RNA that comes out, that's read out of their DNA? And the answer is, when you do a clustering analysis, that there are about 7,000 genes who have an extra coding RNA that's read out in an animal's brain. Okay, so about a third of all the genes that are read out in a neuron have one of these extra coding RNAs that come along with them. Okay, so the part of the question was, you know, is it, if only two genes are regulated this way, maybe it's not so interesting, but if a lot of genes are regulated this way, then maybe it's more interesting. And so that was the idea. So these 7,000 genes that are sort of clustered up in here have the predicted pattern where there's, like for example here, the light blue is, there's not much extra coding RNA, and there's a lot of methylation in the gene, and there's not very much messenger RNA. So that fits the pattern, and this is the mirror image of that. A lot of extra coding RNAs, not very much methylation, and a lot of messenger RNA, okay? So they're in play in the brain. We were interested in looking at their function, and I'm gonna skip over this because Moshe Szyf is the only one that cares, but we directly showed in vitro that the extra coding RNA can inhibit the methyltransferase, directly methylating a gene in a test tube. This is a busy slide. Don't even try to read all of it. Basically, the take-home message is we could make something that's called an antisense oligonucleotide that can bind to RNAs and block their function, okay? Block them being read out or block them doing whatever they do to regulate things. We could make an antisense oligonucleotide, like a designer drug, to inhibit a specific extra coding RNA that regulates the FOS gene that some of you may have heard of. And the point being, we could make this designer drug that could block this ecRNA, and that when we put it in the animal's brain, we could see a degradation of the animal's memory capacity. Okay. So the message is extra coding RNAs regulate memory capacity in the mammalian nervous system. So that's sort of the punchline of all of that. I wouldn't have tortured you with this information, except for the fact that it lets me set up a cool fantasy, science fantasy model for what we might be able to do with this, which is what I'm going to talk about next. So this is the model that I showed you. The idea is these extra coding RNAs are read out of a gene, and they self-regulate the gene that they come from by inhibiting DNA methyltransferases and keep the gene active and making gene product. Okay? So our data are consistent with that model. We did a lot of experiments that this operates in the nervous system. But you can take that model, if it's correct, and you can take it to its sort of conceptual limit, and it's possible that you might be able to manipulate that system and create a self-perpetuating pharmacologic effect. Okay? And I'm going to show you how that might work. And this is all hand-waving. It's all PowerPoint cartoons. It's not real life. It's not data. It's just a thought experiment. Okay? So this is the model I've been talking about. You have these extra coding RNAs that are coming off the gene, and it's also making a gene product in parallel. But what happens if we put an antisense oligonucleotide, one of these designer drugs, on there that can block its function? Okay? People use these to block mRNA readout all the time. We were like, okay, how about if we selectively inhibit extra coding RNA? Okay. Well, if you did that and it blocked the ability of the extra coding RNA to inhibit DNA methyltransferases, then it would free up this pathway to methylate the gene of origin. Okay, this is the model. Once that methylation was there, it would block the production of the ecRNA. Right? And we know that this methylation, like I talked about, can be self-perpetuating through this feedback loop that got us into this whole game to start with. And so conceptually, you could put an antisense oligonucleotide that's targeted to an ecRNA in a cell, set up this negative feedback cycle that's self-perpetuating, and then a single dose of the designer drug could permanently silence the gene. Okay, so that's the fantasy. I'm almost done, that's good. So that is the idea would be that we could make drugs where we could give a single dose one time into the animal's brain, turn off the gene for the rest of the animal's life. Right? So we're going to, we have some proof of concept kind of experiments that I'm going to go through really quickly. So I've told you that histone deacetylases, when you inhibit HDAX, you can improve the animal's memory capacity, right? So we screened 500 antisense oligonucleotides targeted to the HDAC2 gene, the one that's known to be the memory-enhancing HDAC. We found an antisense oligonucleotide that could target the 3' untranslated region, so the putative extra-coding RNA sequence. Put that drug into an animal's brain. We got very nice selectivity for one isoform of HDAC versus the other one, so HDAC2, it worked for HDAC2. We gave one single dose, and it knocked that gene down for 6 months, which is as long as we've looked, and we've gone out to 8 months now. So one dose, and we get a 6 to 8 month pharmacologic knockdown. We like HDAC inhibitors because they're memory enhancers. So these same animals where we had this knockdown, we measured their memory capacity. We can see an enhancement of the animal's memory capacity with this single dose. And this is a model, a mouse model of an intellectual disability syndrome, autism spectrum disorder, Pitt-Hopkins, where we genetically engineered the mice, and the single dose of the drug can restore memory capacity in that intellectual disability model. We've looked at two different Alzheimer's disease models. Again, we see the normal animals, the wild type, we get the memory enhancement, and we get memory restoration in the Alzheimer's disease mouse models with a single dose of the drug, and we're looking 4 to 6 months later in these behavioral experiments. So we have some data that look like we might have triggered a self-perpetuating effect, but we don't know. We're going to continue to investigate that. And we've seen a behavioral consequence of that manipulation, which is memory enhancement. So just the take-home messages overall are very similar to what you've heard already. There's dynamic regulation of the epigenome. Epigenetic mechanisms are involved in behavioral memory formation. Potentially, we might be able to capitalize on this to have a single dose of a drug that gives a very long-lasting effect, and including cognitive enhancement. And this all fits within this unifying model that you're hearing about in all of these talks of epigenetic mechanisms as sort of a universal toolkit for information storage in the cell, in the body. So with that, I'll thank you for your attention and take questions if we have time. Back there.
Particular, I work in forensics, and I'm interested in learning about how this might apply to violent sex offending.
Right, yes. So the good question, and the question was, to paraphrase and make it short, is what about the potential role of these kind of mechanisms with addiction, either for therapeutic potentially or other in other circumstances? And it's a very insightful question. First of all, I'll point out that this is a very vigorous area of investigation among drug addiction researchers, which I am not one, but Eric Nessler, for example, works on this. And part of the reason why addiction researchers are interested in it is because, just like the model that I showed you of this self-perpetuating effect, right, that can persist with a single trigger, that really looks like drug addiction, right? You can take cocaine and do it once, and then you're hooked, right? And it's very, very hard to reverse that. And one of the models that's emerging in addiction is it's because of these epigenetic mechanisms that are self-perpetuating. You do it once, you get the neurons get reprogrammed, and then it's hard to ever take it back. And so that's a part of the answer to your question, which is it's a very vigorous and relevant area of investigation. And of course, then the hope is that we can figure out, you know, in aggregate ways that if epigenetic mechanisms are driving addiction and craving in particular, that maybe we can go in and do some things to epigenetically reprogram it with HDAC inhibitors or something like that to ease the, to facilitate the ability to reverse that addiction phenotype.
How much of a chance is there that these genetic processes that you're trying to change may actually have functional purposes, and that if it is changed, something unexpected might happen?
Right. That's the big concern with trying to use any epigenetically targeted drug, is that you're going to trigger unintended consequences. And so that's the major reservation to all of the stuff that we're doing, for example, with trying to develop epigenetically targeted drugs, is, you know, the fear that we're going to reprogram something and do something really bad, and then you can never get rid of it. So it's like walking through a minefield, which is sort of what you're asking about. My assumption is that that's going to be the case almost universally. Yeah,
the extra coding
RNA. I knew Moshe was going to ask me something hard. That's why I was trying to ignore him.
The extra coding RNA is a fascinating story, but it seems that we will need to block the extra coding RNA if we want to really change the epigenetic state, because they will come back again, you know, in the next round of maintenance methylation.
Right, not when you, in a neuron that's not dividing, once you methylate, you're going to turn off the ecRNA, just like you turn off the gene product, and so the
they're regulated at the under the same promoter.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. So you shut off the ecRNA, and it can never come back on again.
Okay.
Yep.
No.
Yep. Good question. Okay. Thank you. Next speaker.
All right, wow. So it's hard to follow a talk where we're changing the epigenome pharmaceutically, but I'm going to talk more about the social environment in this talk. And I think the state of this field is not as advanced as what you've just heard. But let me first introduce myself. My name is Amy Nan. I'm a genetic anthropologist from University of California, San Diego, and really excited to be here on this panel with all of these esteemed epigeneticists to talk about epigenetics today as a mechanism for embodiment of childhood adversity and implications this may have for racial and social disparities in health. Okay, so as asked, I also put a few points of what I'm going to discuss today, mainly introducing the concept of embodiment of social inequalities, an example of work I've done with methylation in Romanian orphans, and then if we have time, I can touch on implications for racial and social disparities and hypes and holes and unanswered questions as well. So this is kind of the conceptual framework that's motivated much of my research in the past few years. I'm interested in this idea of epigenetics as a mechanism for embodiment. And when I say embodiment, I mean literally the incorporation of the environment, the social and physical environment, into our biology to chemically alter our biology and change the trajectory of our health throughout our lives. This is a popular concept now in epidemiology, social epidemiology, psychology, anthropology, and my personal interest in it is in the social environment, things that are related to the sociocultural, political, economic context, the larger framework of our lives that shape the more proximate exposures, things like pollution and diet and exercise that are all nested within these larger social, political forces, and how that gets incorporated directly into our epigenome, which then interacts with our genotype to alter gene expression and lead to variation in our phenotype, which we've heard about all morning. So I just want to hone in today on my interest in embodiment happening early in childhood. I think that epigenetic influences can also be important in adulthood, and particularly in different critical windows of development like pregnancy, and childhood and fetal reproduction. Today I'm going to talk about an example about childhood which may be a particularly vulnerable stage of development where environmental exposures could have a bigger impact than other parts of life. But I also think, of course, fetal development is extremely critical window, and I think there are periods throughout life where we've yet to discover that are also vulnerable to epigenetic influence. And why I'm interested in childhood also is because if we can figure out what those exposures are early in life, maybe we can intervene early enough to change that trajectory of a child's life and prevent racial and social disparities and help from developing. Okay, so the example I want to talk to you about today is from my work collaborating with researchers at Harvard and Tulane in Maryland on the Bucharest Early Intervention Project. Some of you might be familiar with this work. It's a really amazing, ongoing, longitudinal study that's been going since the year 2000, and it's the first randomized study in the world to investigate the effects of foster care on improving child health outcomes, psychological outcomes, behavioral, social outcomes. And it's really a great example for this work because it's such a severe example of early childhood deprivation. These Romanian orphanages are pretty unfriendly towards children. You've got a large ratio of caretaker to child. There's not a lot of attention for every child. So it's an example of poor maternal care, but in an extreme case. And in Romania, this is particularly common because in the 1960s, there was a communist dictatorship that encouraged very large families to encourage an independent workforce where they didn't need to rely on bringing in outside workers. And so a lot of families were encouraging many children, tax penalties for every child less than five that you had, and tax benefits for every additional child. So there were policies in place to encourage huge families that families couldn't afford to care for. And so then they started building a lot of institutions like orphanages and encouraging families to just let the orphanages raise their children. And so at the time, they actually didn't know that this could be as harmful as we've now discovered that it is for the psychological health of these children. And a lot of the work coming out of this Bucharest Early Intervention Project has shown how harmful this was, and they've actually reversed a lot of these policies. They now discourage the use of institutions for raising children, especially under the age of two. So just to outline the study design, this is really one of the only cases where we can randomize these early life experiences. I think it was Moshe that said that we usually can't randomize, but in this case, they were able to randomize by recruiting children that are in institutions already from six different orphanages around Bucharest. And then they randomized them out of the orphanages into a foster care system. So this stands for a care as usual group. Those stayed in the orphan system. And then the foster care group were randomized out of the orphanages into a newly developed foster care program in Romania that was developed for the purpose of this study. And there was no foster care system in place before the study began. So at 22 months of age, they took the children, randomized them out of the foster care system, and then followed them for now 16 plus years, measuring them at many, many different stages. Here at the time, 30 months up to 16 years of psychological, behavioral, biological, brain scans, blood samples, saliva samples at all these different stages. And then, of course, there's a third group of the never institutionalized group that were recruited from the community that had never been raised in an orphanage. So we've got three different groups. Ideally, we could compare these three groups and have an unbiased estimate of the effect of institutionalization. For the case of my study, we actually treated the institutionalization as a continuous variable of the percent of the life of the child that had been spent in the institution, rather than looking at the three groups separately, because they didn't always stay in those three groups, and they didn't all enter into institutional care at the exact same age or developmental stage. So it was a more informative variable to measure the percent of their lifetime that had been spent in institutional care rather than sticking with the three groups. Okay, so whenever we talk about the Bucharest study, it's really important to bring up some of these ethical concerns, which I'm sure some of you are thinking about, and we can talk about them afterwards if you have more questions. There's been nearly a dozen articles written about the ethical implications and concerns related to this kind of research. I just want to touch on a couple of points. so they don't distract us from the rest of the study. So one concern is exploitation. Are we exploiting these vulnerable children and doing this research in the first place? And I think that the reason it's not an example of exploitation is because the Romanian government invited these researchers into the country for the purpose of studying this question. And at the time, they weren't aware of all the implications that this institutional care could have, and so they were actively seeking out researchers to come and help them answer this question. The researchers didn't bring the question to them. The other point that's important is non-interference. If a child were to be adopted by a family, they never interfered with any natural process that would have happened in the life of a child. So if they were entered into some other family situation, that was never interfered with. The risk-benefit ratio is really positive here because there was no foster care system in place. So what they developed was really a rich, beneficial system for the children. And the results of the study led to so much knowledge that helped reverse this practice of institutionalization at a really young age. And then after the study ended, they didn't end the foster care system. They just stopped doing all of the psychological assessments at all the time points, and they stopped funding the study of it, but the foster care system continued, and then the Romanian government developed their own foster care system. So I think at a point here, they started their own network of foster care, and they banned orphan care below age 2. So if you want to learn more about the ethics of the design of the study, I encourage you to go to all of these other articles specifically about ethics. And there's a great book that recently came out about summarizing the BEIP's findings thus far. So I just want to touch on these findings before I get to the epigenetics study that I've conducted. There's amazing research that's come out about cognitive and emotional outcomes in these children. The children that remained in the orphanages in the care as usual group for the long term actually had lower IQs than those who were randomized out into the foster care system when it was measured at 8 years. They had worse language development, less secure attachment to their caregivers, more emotional and behavioral problems, and then the children that were randomized out actually had a reversal of all of those negative cognitive and emotional outcomes. So even though they were in the institutions up to 22 months, they were able to reverse those with the foster care system after that point. So that's encouraging. There's also been a lot of really exciting findings on the behavioral or biological side. Though I know that we shouldn't always distinguish biological from cognitive and emotional, as we know now, there's no strict dichotomy, but the way the researchers define it, there was altered stress physiology, blunted cortisol responses to stress tasks in the laboratory setting. So that gave us a clue that something epigenetic might be going on to regulate that stress physiology. Abnormalities in white brain matter, and this is just a sample of a plot from a study that showed higher cortical white matter in those that were in the never institutionalized group compared to the foster care group, and they were higher, not significantly so, from the care as usual group. But this care as usual, the institutionalized group, was significantly had less white cortical brain matter than the never institutionalized group, which is a pretty dramatic difference that you could think has a lot of implications. Blunted brain response to pictures of faces. These are psychological measures I'm sure some of you are familiar with. And the first genetic finding was that there were shorter telomeres actually in the children who had spent more time in institutional care. And these two plots are showing for girls and boys. The more time along the x-axis, more proportion of their life spent institutionalized was associated with reduction in the length of their telomeres, which are the repetitive DNA sequences at the ends of the chromosomes, thought of as a marker of cellular aging. So thinking that their cells are aging faster the more they spend in institutional care. Though this effect was seen more in boys than it was in girls, and there's a lot of speculation about gender differences in vulnerabilities that we don't have time to talk about today. So my study objective was to look at DNA methylation in the children from buccal swabs. These are epithelial cells that were taken at age 12 in the children, and see how the percent of their time spent in institutions correlated with methylation at particular genes I was interested in the buccal cells. So we chose two stress-related genes. Ideally, I would have looked at the entire genome, but there just wasn't enough DNA or funding to support that at the time. So we chose some hypothesis-driven genes that are related to stress response systems, some of which you heard about from Moshe's talk, the glucocorticoid receptor. So I specifically was interested in FKBP5 because it's involved in the glucocorticoid receptor complex, the same one that's involved in the licking and grooming mice that you've heard about, and the serotonin receptor, which I'm sure most of you are familiar with in psychology, regulates transport of serotonin. And both of these genes are involved in the inhibitory feedback loop of regulation of cortisol. So I call them stress-related genes because they're involved in this HPA axis, the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis, and there's this nice feedback when you have a lot of stress causes release of cortisol, which then causes a negative feedback regulation back to the hypothalamus to downregulate the release of cortisol and shut itself off. But this downregulation can be interfered with when you have an extreme amount of stress, and that's what we're hypothesizing is happening through methylation of these genes. So the first one I mentioned, FKBP5, has been studied in relation to early life trauma by some research by Klengel et al. And a few others. Early life trauma, like child abuse, was actually associated with lower levels of methylation in the blood of children and adults, measured in childhood and adulthood and looking back to their early life trauma. And what they found was decreased methylation at this gene right here. These little M's you can barely see are decreased methylation in this particular intron in the glucocorticoid receptor complex. It's actually, I wanted to show you the gene, the way it's folded up very complex here, because this is an enhancer region that, because of the articulation of the folds of the gene, is actually talking with the transcription start site of the gene and enhancing the expression of the gene. But when there is reduced methylation, it's enhancing the expression of this gene, which then actually reduces the efficiency of the feedback regulation of the gene. Okay, the other gene I mentioned was the serotonin transporter gene, also called SERT, what you might have heard of, and it regulates synaptic levels of serotonin in the synapses between the neurons. I'm sure you're aware it's a neurotransmitter. Serotonin is a neurotransmitter important for mood regulation and implicated in depression. And increased methylation in this gene is associated with reduced expression of the transporter, which is linked with increased circulation of serotonin because the transporter can't then remove it from circulation as well. And this has been studied in rhesus macaques and adults exposed to early life stress, and they found increased methylation in the adults and in the macaques. But interestingly, because there's so many open questions with methylation, the opposite has also been found, decreased methylation in the second trimester of pregnancy, in particular of mothers with depression during pregnancy. In the second trimester, they found decreased methylation at this gene. So it wasn't clear to us which direction we might see it or whether it's good or bad to have increased or decreased methylation at this point. Okay, so here's a quick snapshot of our results. We actually found in some of the CPG sites in both of our genes, we looked at 5 or 6 sites in each gene, we found increasing time spent in institutional care associated with a slight decrease in methylation. Here at one CPG site in FKBP5 and at 2 different CPG sites in SLC6A4, the serotonin gene. And this one, FKBP5, was associated with the percent of institutionalization measured at baseline. So when the children were 22 months of age, the percent of their life that had been spent in the care at that point was associated with decreased methylation. Whereas in the serotonin gene, it was more significant at 30 months of age, the percent of their life at 30 months of age associated with decreased methylation at age 12. So it was also associated when measured at other time points as well. So these plots are just showing you the associations in the ever institutionalized children, leaving out the children that had never been institutionalized, because we actually found stronger associations when only looking in the children who had ever spent time in an institution, which is a combination of that care as usual and foster care group. Okay, and just to mention, these regressions were so adjusted for age and gender, ethnicity, which was either Romanian or Roma, gypsy, and pubertal status measured with Tanner stage. Okay, so to summarize, that the time spent in institutional care was negatively correlated with methylation in both genes when measured in age 12 in the buccal cells, and this was consistent with other research that has been done on these children with cortisol reactivity and increased risk of psychopathology at age 12. We found different timings of measurement of when it was important, the percent of their life institutionalized, different timings for each gene suggest there might be some gene-specific sensitive periods where different time periods are more important than others for specific genes. So it's very complicated of when you measure these things in addition to what the exposure is. And we just need a lot more research to figure out if this is really a causal pathway or not. What are the downstream behavioral and physiological, psychological outcomes of this change? It was a very small change, I'll say. Each percent increase in institutionalization was associated with 1 to 2% decrease in methylation, but that can accumulate over a lifetime of 10 years of institutionalization could be up to 10 to 20% decrease in methylation. But what that means in terms of biology and psychology is still an open question. So I just wanted to touch on what the implications of this research are for social and racial inequalities in health. So this is an extreme example I've presented to you of social deprivation in early childhood, but you can think of other examples of poverty, discrimination, trauma, chronic stressors that different racial minorities are exposed to that are early in life, both in pregnancy and in early childhood, that could have similar effect on the methylation of their offspring. And if it's changing in pregnancy or in early childhood, it's setting up these trajectories of worse health that actually could be setting up intergenerational cycles, passing on these effects over generations that look like they could be genetic, but are actually maybe epigenetic because of the recapitulation of these experiences every generation, but also because it's changing the health of the mother during pregnancy. If in her childhood she was exposed to a chronic stressor, then her child's methylation could be different, and then when that child grows up, if its biology or psychology is impaired, it's going to have worse health as an adult, and if it's a woman, its womb, its fetal environment that it's setting up could be impaired. So setting off this cycle of repeating the methylation and repeating the poor health over generations. So that's where I think that we need more research to figure out where is it best to reverse this cycle, break this cycle, and is it really being passed on intergenerationally, not through the germline, but through the behavior and the health of the mother over generations? Or maybe it is through the germline, we don't know that yet either. So I just wanted to spend my last minute introducing my current ongoing research to try to look at racial disparities in health in particular and in methylation in Hispanic immigrants, which is what I've been working on for the past few years. I didn't have any epigenetic results yet to share with you, but we're working on them right now. And I've developed this study while I was at Vanderbilt the past 2 years ago to look at children of Mexican immigrants that are exposed to a lot of stress due to their immigrant status. And I was interested in the biological embedding of this stress that might dysregulate their HPA axis and lead to higher risk of cardiometabolic disease, but also could have implications for psychological outcomes as well. I collected a sample of, the goal was 100 families. We didn't quite reach it before I moved from Vanderbilt to San Diego, but we got 82 families where we interviewed the mothers and the children between ages 6 and 12 and tried to measure all kinds of stressors the mothers and children were reporting during early childhood that might affect the children's health. And we took saliva and buccal swabs and blood pressure measures and BMI. And we're now generating data on methylation at these same genes and genome-wide. And we're trying to figure out if there is variation in methylation related to their experiences of stress in early childhood. So to end, I just wanted to say there's still so many open questions and future directions. in this field of social behavioral epigenetics. We heard about them in the beginning, but we're still trying to figure out the severity of exposures that matter for methylation and what critical time points matter, magnitude of methylation changes that can change a phenotype. There's this huge issue of tissue specificity, since every tissue has its own methylation pattern, and we can only get the accessible tissues in most studies of children, like saliva and blood, and what does that mean in terms of biology or psychological outcomes, which genomic regions we should be looking at, the role of the genome in interacting with the epigenome, especially with racial disparities, because there are racial genetic differences between some racial backgrounds, but do those interact with the epigenome in different ways? And are effects transgenerational or intergenerational? I think intergenerational, I use transgenerational to mean through the germline, intergenerational to mean otherwise passed on across generations. And in terms of the hype, I just wanted to mention, I think we should not get carried away that everything is epigenetic, because there are many other pathways as well, and DNA methylation is only one epigenetic pathway out of others, like non-coding RNAs. So we should be open-minded that it might not all be epigenetic. Thank you.